Vortex generators. Some swear by them, some say don't even bother. As a matter of fact, Kitfox told me not to bother with them. They claim to have tested them all and none of them worked well. So is this really truth? They don't work at all for the Kitfox? Well, let's find out. Let's start with the basics. When we are at cruise speeds, our angle of attack is zero, and the air flowing through the wing is not disrupted, so the air flows really nicely. However, when we need to fly slow, we need to increase the angle of attack. When the angle of attack is increased, the air flowing through the top of the wing loses its bite, it starts to separate away from the wing, and lift is lost. The reason the airflow separates away from the wing is because the air flowing really close to the wing surface slows down to friction, creating drag and slowing the surrounding airflow. This causes the air to separate away from the wing and the airplane loses lift. So how do we fix that? How do we make the airflow stick to the wing when we have a high angle of attack? Well, this is when VGs become useful. In order to minimize the airflow friction to the wing, we need to energize the air a little bit. So this is how it works. We place the VGs close to the leading edge, twisted at approximately 15 degree angle. When the air flows through that area, it hits the side of the walls of the VGs. By hitting the VGs walls, it creates these mini vortexes, which initially accelerates the airflow, but more importantly, reduces the possibilities of the airflow get dragged close to the wing surface. That way, the air flowing through the wing stays closer to the wing, from the leading edge all the way closer to the trailing edge. This creates lift at much lower speeds, enabling the airplane to be controlled and responsive at a very high angle of attack. So that's basically how VGs work. So the million-dollar question is, how does VGs work with the Kitfox wing? After all, Kitfox told me they don't work at all. Well, we decided to model the Kitfox wing, bring to a fluid motion simulator, and test it. Most of us believe and understand the benefits of VGs. I am one of them, but the question that always seems to be unanswered is where exactly to place the VGs. No one really knows where to properly place them in order to take full advantage of them. There's a calculation on where to put them based on percentage. For example, I wanted to place the VGs at 5%. You take the chord length, for example, 1500 millimeters, you multiply that by 5 and divide by 100. The result is 75 millimeters, which is the distance that represents 5%. That means the tip of the VG should be 75 millimeters from the leading edge. The same calculation applies for other percentages, 10, 7, and 3% for instance. But what nobody knows is the actual percentage to place them. Some say 10%, some say 7%, and some just do what others tell them to do. The truth is, you don't really know until you test them. So where's the correct percentage of chord that we should place the VGs for the Kitfox wing? We run the simulation at three different groups. Group A, the control group, we place the angle of attack, or AOA, at 0 degree, so we just have a baseline. Group B, we place the AOA to 15 degree, and group C, we move the AOA to 25 degree. I chose 15 degree because it's the 3-point landing position of most Kitfoxes, and 25 degree because it's the laning configuration when you're coming behind the power curve with a high AOA for the purpose of laning short, which is where you need the VGs the most. Anything less than 15 degrees is good because there's not much angle of attack and less tendency of the airflow to separate. With group A, as anticipated, we basically see no airflow separation at all. We don't have any angle of attack, so the air flows through the wing without any issues. Even with VGs at zero AOA, the air seems to flow the same way. We don't anticipate to lose any cruise speeds, even with the VGs. With group B, we run the data without VGs first, and then VGs at 7 and 3% of the chord line. Without VGs, it doesn't look that bad at all. It seems like 15 degree AOA does not affect the Kitfox wing that much. Interestingly, same happens when we place the VGs at 7 and 3% of chord line. So if you're landing at 15 degree or less, the wing should fly relatively well still, regardless with or without VGs. Perhaps this is the reason why Kitfox suggests that VGs are ineffective. According to the simulation, the number seems that at 15 degree AOA, VGs might not show its full potential. Here's a quick look comparing all data at 15 degree. With group C at 25 degree of AOA, we see a completely different story. We basically did the same simulation running the data without VG first, and then running at 7 and 3% of chord line. Without VGs, you can see a very significant airflow separation. Basically, the wing has no grab at all, and the airflow separates off the wing relatively early. With VGs positioned at 7%, we see a little improvement. However, there is also a noticeable airflow separation. Now, with VGs at 3%, we see a substantial improvement where the airflow stays tight to the wing, almost towards the trailing edge. This is where we have been looking for, finding the percentage of chord line where the VGs can be placed to maximize performance. Here's a quick look comparing the data at 25 degree. As you can see, VGs definitely work on keeping the airflow tight to the wing with a high angle of attack. More specifically, it seems that 3% of chord is the most effective way to place the VGs on the Kitfox. Now, it's important to share some data points for this simulation. All the data had airflow simulated at 40 miles per hour. I chose 40 miles per hour because it is the slowest I can go without VGs on my Kitfox. All simulations were performed at full flaps, which in my case, they're positioned at a 40 degree angle. Also, it's important to mention that we spaced the VGs at 60 millimeters apart. Because the Kitfox uses flaperons and the whole length of the wing is control surfaces, we wanted to have the VGs closer together to maximize efficiency. Some VGs manufacturers might suggest to space them at 90 millimeters where there are no control surfaces, and 60 millimeters at control surfaces. To have some additional fun, we model up some different VG styles found online. Some longer, double wings, and we notice some of them to have worse results compared to the ones we tested. We even tried to stack them where some were at 3% and some were at 7%, but found the results to be better than just leaving at 3%. By the way, the Vortex generators we used for this simulation was from a company called Stowspeed. We chose them because they seemed simple to install and less prone to cut your fingers while cleaning the leading edge. They have rounded edges rather than metal sharp ones, and they're also made of plastic. So there you have it. If you have a regular Kitfox wing and want to install Vortex generators, here's what you do. You go purchase them, you paint them, don't be lazy, make them look good. Install them at 3% of chord, theoretically, we still have to fly and test it, space them at 60 millimeters apart, and go win some stall competitions. So for the next video, or maybe the following one, come along with me as we install the VGs at 3% and we compare the data we have. Hopefully the simulation will confirm to be useful data that we can apply in real flying. As always, thanks for watching. If you are new to this channel, consider subscribing. I do some of these engineering videos along with some flying videos. I'll see you guys on the next one.